and if you can address some of the questions in your presentations or in your discussions, will be great. And then I'll moderate the questions after the sessions as we go.
Sure, that would be
great. Thank you. Welcome on board, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Chua. So I'm going to jump right in. So while estate and succession planning are often used interchangeably, they are two separate kinds of plans, right? So estate planning deals with the management and distribution of your assets upon death, and it can be executed through a will or a trust, wherein a will be the document that states exactly how you want to distribute your assets and whom do you want to give them to after your death. It ensures that your assets are distributed to the right people. On the other hand, succession planning is deciding who is going to take over your business upon your retirement, death, or disability. So to write a succession plan, the first step is to identify the ideal successors and then determine the best arrangements for a smooth transition. So of course, both these processes require significant thought and consideration on your part before you jump into planning or preparing of any of them. And Mr. Desai and I will try and cover most of the important considerations while making them, right? So Mr. Desai, can you please talk about why is it so important to make a will, and what can happen, what can go wrong if you don't write one?
Thank you, Panna, for opening up the session. Basically, what is a will? I'll start by that. Of course, everyone knows what a will is, but will basically is the wish of a person as to what the person wants to do with his assets, how he wants to distribute them after he passes on to the next world, you know. So what can happen in a will? You can distribute your movables, immovables, everything. What is more important is what happens when a person doesn't make a will. When a person doesn't make a will, it's left to the law. Law is applicable to you, that will take over, and the assets and properties will be distributed in accordance with the personal law of the person. Say somebody is a Hindu, then the property will go as per Hindu law. Suppose somebody belongs to another religion, then that religious law will apply and the property will be distributed accordingly. So therefore, will making is very important. And as I say, I have coined this myself and I've used it often. A will is a kind of personal legislation which the law has given you the right to do. If you don't do that, you are losing the chance to legislate upon your own properties as to their succession. Therefore, will planning making is a very important aspect of a person's overall planning in life.
So a will would not only allow you to include the correct beneficiaries, but it will also allow you to exclude some people that might not be deserving of your legacy, right?
Of course, yes.
Yeah. And if you don't make one, you know, it usually leads to unnecessary worry or stress for your family members, family arguments, or there can be a delay in the distribution of your assets. Or there can also be possible litigation costs if the family ends up in court.
Yes, of course, because again, to carry forward what you said, what would happen if a will is not made? What you said goes right to the root of the matter. First of all, the heirs would be running around trying to find out and locate various documents as to where everything is, you know, shares, deposits, insurance policies, and everything which deals with the financials of a person. So, of course, these things are important and they must be put at one place. There must be a separate understanding or a separate instruction to a trusted person. Say, suppose a man is making a will. Probably his wife must be told as to where everything is, including the will. That is important. Location of documents is very important.
So, Mr. Desai, can you take us over the process of writing a will?
Yes. I would like to simplify it in this manner. See, any assets that a person has are classified into two categories. One is movable, the other is immovable property. amongst this class of properties, a person can distribute, say, movables in a particular manner. Say, suppose he owns, say, cars, or he owns paintings or sculptures, for example, and they are quite expensive. Whom does he want them to go to? That can be dealt with. Now, immovable property is a slightly difficult proposition in the sense that the person has to make a choice. If it is his own self-acquired property, person has to make a choice as to whom he wants to leave the property to, in what manner. Does he want to give a full right over the property to the person, or a limited right during the lifetime of that person? All these things can and should be mentioned in the will. That is how the distribution takes place. Now, apart from the actual heirs, say sons, daughters, wife, etc., there might be other people whom you want to leave something to. Say some old family retainers, people who are working in your place since, say, 20 years, 30 years. You might want to leave them something, maybe some cash amounts due to love and affection. That also can be mentioned in the will. So all these things can be mentioned in the will.
I'm going to run you through some points from my end. So one, you first start by listing down all your assets. Okay. Decide who you want your beneficiaries to be. Of course, decide if you have minor children, you also need to decide the guardian and trustees for your children in case you're no longer there with them. You have to appoint an executor. You legally only require one executor who will help execute all your wishes in the will. But to be prudent, it's better to have two of them. So the second will be a backup. You need two witnesses. And of course, you need to state that this will was made in a sound state of mind without any coercion. Okay. For a will to be valid, it is mandatory that both the witnesses are present with you physically when you sign it. Because if a witness has to attest in court that this indeed is your true will, then they have to witness you signing it, basically. So this is something that usually people are not aware about. They sign it and then they send it to their witness and the witness signs it there. This cannot work. You need to all three be present in the same location when you sign it. When you choose your executor, it should typically be a person who is younger than you, and it's better if they're not a beneficiary of the will. So try and pick a neutral, fair party who understands the family dynamics. And it can be any trusted person, such as a family friend, doctor, CA, lawyer, anybody. A few of non-legal considerations when you're preparing your will. It can be written on a blank piece of paper, by clean white paper. So ensure that the quality of the paper is good, because this document has to be retained over a longer period of time. Okay, try and store it in a full-sized envelope without any folds. It can be stored safely in your bank. And like Mr. Desai said, please, please, please inform your family about where your will is stored. Because if you go through all this and they still cannot locate your will, then it serves no purpose, right? And do not, of course, keep two copies. One in the safe, and you can give one of them to the beneficiaries or the executor. But do not make too many copies, because it ultimately creates confusion. Yeah. So we're going to run you through some common mistakes that you can make or that you should avoid while writing a will. Mr. Desai, can you lead, please?
Sure. But before we go to that, just to add to what you said, if one of the witnesses to the will is a doctor, what is the advantage in that? The advantage here is that suppose the will is challenged on, say, a ground that the person was not in a proper frame of mind, was not mentally stable. The doctor can attest to the fact, can testify to the fact in court that no, the will has been signed. I was present, and the person who signed the will, that is the testator, was in proper frame of mind. There was nothing wrong with him. That is an important aspect. Now, I'll request you to repeat your earlier question so that we can go through it once again.
So, I wanted to run through common mistakes that happen while preparing a will.
Yes. first thing that must be done is clear instructions or directions about distribution must be given. Say, suppose you want to leave a particular thing to a particular person. It must be mentioned clearly in the will. Directions must not be vague at all. Secondly, the names of the beneficiaries must be clearly mentioned, if possible, with their current addresses. Thirdly, of course, it must be again clearly mentioned as to who gets what property. Sometimes it may happen that suppose, say, an immovable property, a large immovable property is there and it has to be distributed amongst four people. How to do that will be a question. If there are four, of course, it can be divided into four equal parts, then, but what must be mentioned is who gets what portion of the property, if it is divisible in that manner. Otherwise, of course, the simplest thing to do is get rid of the property, distribute the money. But property also has its own emotional value, I would say. And the family might want to retain it, might want to stay in the same property, but having divided it as per the wishes of the testator. So clear directions must be there as to who gets what portion in the will. Now, as you rightly mentioned, one of the biggest do's is that care must be taken that the testator and the witnesses, they sign simultaneously, because the witnesses must see that the testator has signed the will, and the testator must see that the witnesses have witnessed it together. As per law, I'll mention here, it is not necessary at all for the witnesses to know as to what the contents of the will are. They just need to know that this is the person's will and that we are witnessing it. Now, if I come to the don'ts of making a will, they are more important. There are two or three, but they are more important. One is, a person cannot make a will or not include in a will property that he or she does not own. Now, this is of particular interest to people who follow the Hindu religion, I would say. And why is that? Because amongst Hindus, we have what is known as coparcenary property or HUF property. Everybody has a part in the property. So the question arises, can a person make a will of, say, coparcenary property? People were confused earlier that no, coparcenary property is by survivorship. It's held jointly, so how can I make a will about that? But no, here the law comes to the aid of Hindus, says that Section 30 of the Hindu Succession Act says that you can make a will of property that you also have control over. Therefore, say, suppose I am making a will apart from my self-acquired property or self-earned property, I can make a will of a portion, a probable portion that I may have in the coparcenary. I cannot say that this particular portion goes to XYZ or this goes to ABC, because it is like a pizza pie, you know, to give an example. You don't know which part of the pizza belongs to you because it's not cut up yet. So you can just say that I own an interest in coparcenary property. I will away my coparcenary interest to XYZ. That can happen. But here importantly, say a person, say suppose he's a karta of an HUF or a coparcenary. And this is in relation to family businesses also in a way, because many family businesses are run by the family. You cannot, as a karta, deal with the whole of the coparcenary property. You can't will it away. Why? Because you are affecting the rights of the other coparceners. The karta is just the manager. He can probably deal with his portion of the property, but not the whole of the property while he is making a will, especially. Secondly, and most importantly, a will cannot override the provisions of the law. A will cannot be made so as to see that you are breaching the law, you are breaking the law. A recent example, today's newspapers, I will quote, just 2 days back, the Supreme Court has delivered a very, very important judgment. What used to happen is that a person, say, suppose he holds agricultural land, he would will it away to a person, say, who is not from his family, a rank outsider. The Supreme Court has upheld the decision of the Gujarat High Court and said, of course, the Supreme Court decision is applicable throughout the country, that an agricultural land cannot be willed away to a person who is a non-agriculturist. That is precisely what I meant, that it cannot, a will cannot override the provisions of the law. See, suppose the law says that certain thing cannot happen, then you cannot override that by a will.
So what happens to an asset if it is willed to a non-agricultural person, or what if somebody dies intestate?
See, if an asset is willed to a non-agricultural person, then of course that portion of the will would be void and it would go back to the estate. Law, yes, but now even as per the Supreme Court judgment. Now, suppose a person dies intestate, then of course his heirs would come in. His or her heirs would come in and they would of course be entitled, because yes, it can be inherited that way, but it cannot go to an outsider who is a non-agriculturist.
Okay, fair enough.
So, that is the second thing. And third, that a will cannot override the provisions of the law. Namely, if I simplify it, say in certain states, in three states in India, probate is compulsory if you own immovable property in those states, but not in the other states. A will cannot be made so as to override the provisions of the law. Here, the lawyer would also be at fault and the client would also be at fault. You cannot avoid probate if probate is necessary and required as per law. That's the only example that I would give so far as overriding provisions of law are concerned. These are basically and broadly the don'ts of a will.
So there are many times when I'm working with my clients and, you know, we talk about estate planning and there are so many things that I see are going wrong before we step in. So, of course, the most common mistake in estate planning is not making a will. Many people think that making a will is something that you need to do towards the end of your life. But it's actually a standard wealth managing process across all age groups. If you think about it in, from an international perspective, making a will is part of your financial planning process, right? So there are many times when my investors argue with me that I have nominations in most of my assets. So that's good enough, you know, why do I need a separate will? But that's a misconception, because many people confuse a nominee as a beneficiary for an asset, which is not true. A nominee is just a trustee or a caretaker of your assets, not the owner. So he is a person who is appointed to transfer your asset to the correct legal heir after your death. You know, so the will is a supreme document. In case a nominee is challenged in court, the will have the power to override a nominee. So in that case, it is possible that the nominee might not necessarily end up with your asset. So despite having nominations in place, it is very important to create a will. Third point is, there are many times in business families especially when the assets are actually divided in multiple people's names, but only the head of the family has a will in place. But that is not a good practice to have. Everybody owning any asset, you know, even insurance policies, mutual funds, anything, if you own in your name, even jewelry, you know, anybody who holds even one single asset needs a will in that case. Okay. When it comes to families with minor children, a will becomes an absolute must, because in an unfortunate circumstance, if both the parents are to die without a will, and there is no then there's no person entrusted to ensure that your children are looked after and their assets are protected until they come of age. So a will would allow you to appoint different trustees and guardians. So it's a good idea for young parents with young children. And one thing that you should keep in mind is that it's better if the witness and their spouse are not beneficiaries of the will as well. So, because sometimes it can make a will invalid. So choose a witness who has nothing to gain from your death.
To add to what Panna said, one, of course, about witnesses and the second about nomination. Witnesses, I completely agree with you. They must be absolutely independent. So far as nominees are concerned, what happens is, say, suppose somebody has made nominations somewhere and the person dies intestate. Question would arise as to, does the nominee get the asset? No. Then what would happen is that the heirs would have to demand that asset or that amount from the nominee, because as Panna said, the nominee is only a trustee in order to collect the amount. Suppose the nominee retains the amount and does not give it to the heirs, then they can demand it. If not, then they can file a case against the nominee for return of that amount. It may also happen that one of the nominees might himself or herself be an heir, but that does not mean that the person whose property it was has given it to that person, because it would be distributed amongst all as per the law of intestate succession applicable to the person.
So, Smriti, to answer your question, according to the Indian law, it is not compulsory to register it or to write it on stamp paper or anything. However, if you register it, it simply puts an end to all doubts that can be raised over its authenticity. So, when you register it, the registrar's office will also keep a copy. So, that can specially come in handy in case the will is lost. Just to wrap up this part of the conversation. So, a will can be revoked, modified, or changed at any point during your lifetime. You know, you will generally, Mr. Desai, can you help me here?
Sure.
Would we include a clause at the end that can state any future asset that I own can be divided as per so and so, or is that not allowed?
Of course. In fact, it is almost mandatory by way of practice now, I would say. That is known as the residuary clause in law. Say a person lists all his assets, say movables and immovables. Then there is a clause that any property that I may hereinafter get or obtain will be distributed amongst my heirs in the following manner. That can be stated, or it can also be stated that it can be distributed amongst my heirs in an equal proportion. That is known as the residuary clause. Now, okay, coming to your point about registration, I will add something here. See, suppose, as you rightly said, registration of a will is not compulsory at all. It's voluntary. And there is a procedure to be followed on registration. But say, suppose someone wants to revoke, means cancel a registered will. What happens? Okay, the process of cancellation can be done. Thereafter, if the person wants to make a fresh will, what will happen? If you have already made a will and it is registered and you cancel that will, then the next will also has to be registered.
Okay.
Of course, if the will is not registered, this question does not arise.
That's an
You can make a new will. Of course, it has to be mentioned whether the will is registered or not. You have to mention that I hereby cancel and revoke my earlier wills.
Okay.
That has to happen.
So, as your circumstances change, you will need to keep revising your will and keep it up to date. So, it's a good practice to review your will every 3 or 4 years and make amendments whenever there are major changes in assets, family additions or subtractions, or any emotional developments that might want to make you alter your older wills. Like Mr. Desai said, remember that if you make a second, third, fourth will, ensure that you make a declaration which states that you are revoking all previous wills. And if you have registered the first will, you must register all the preceding wills, all the wills going ahead as well. So,
Mohini Mahadevia has raised a question here. I could see it on the screen. Welcome, Mohini. Registration cost would differ from state to state, but it is not too much, I would say. That would be as per the schedule in every state. Right? Cost of registration is not much.
Okay. So, Mr. Desai, I have one very specific question that came in from the participants before we started.
Yes.
it says that, and it's the opinion that he's seeking from you.
Yes.
So if you have properties and investments and you decide to divide them equally between, say, two children at the current market prices,
yes,
later some of them might take off and some of them might not end up doing so well. And then you've not created a fair division, right? Mm. So if you wanted to give them an equal share, but at the same time, you want to ensure their independence to sell them if they want to, you know, if you get, if you say that, okay, I'm going to equally divide everything, but if one person doesn't want to sell the property and one person needs the liquidity, how do you go about dividing it? Like, what would you suggest?
See, I'll probably try and quote a small example later on. But say, suppose someone owns substantial property and he or she decides to divide it equally, as you said, or as the querist said, amongst, say, two of his sons or two daughters, whatever children he has. He does that. He divides the property, right? Division has already taken place. That property was self-acquired property of the person. He dealt with it very fairly. Market vagaries, you can never take care of. Valuations may increase or may decrease, but for that reason, it will not be open to any challenge whatsoever. Say, if we speak about, say, division of properties, then without naming the family, one of the most prominent families in India undertook a division of businesses by way of business planning. But one did not do that well and has not been doing that well. The other has taken off, practically sees the moon right now. I would not name, everybody would have understood. But that has happened. Those are market vagaries. Then your own capabilities, all that comes into play. Okay. Nothing can be done about that, at least at the hands of the person who has made the will.
Fair enough. So to summarize the will portion, you know, a will allows you to do the following. One is division of assets. Two, appoint trustees and guardians for minor children. Three, provide provisions for continuity of your business, which we will discuss further in the succession planning part. What you can also do through a living will is give healthcare directives. So if you become unable to make medical decisions for yourself, if you prepare a living will, it can allow you to give power of attorney to a certain individual who can make decisions on your behalf. Similarly, you can also create a financial power of attorney. So in case you are incapacitated to make decisions for yourself, the power of attorney will be able to take all financial decisions for you on your behalf. Mr. Desai, anything that you would like to add in the will making process here?
Yes. On the last portion that you said, very well put. But here I would like to address our viewers on one aspect, one very important aspect. A living will, as it is named, is very much prevalent in Western countries, especially in the United States and Europe. Now, what is a living will needs to be told to our viewers? A living will basically takes care of a situation where a person is incapacitated and suppose he has various interests, those interests cannot stagnate. So that can be taken care of by way of a living will. But there is a big change or a difference so far as India and the Western world are concerned. In India, the concept of living wills is not recognized at all, but it is only limited to making a living will or such a document which can take care of your health care issues. Say, suppose a person has made such a document, what would it mention? Say, suppose he gets into a life-threatening situation like, say, COVID-19 right now. I'm just quoting an example. Person goes into a coma for a long time. What happens? He can say or she can say in that living will that I do not want to be resuscitated. No artificial living apparatus be used on me, and I may be allowed to leave this world without any further medical intervention. In fact, why has this happened? There is a public society called Common Cause, which files public interest litigations on very important issues and has done so in the past. This judgment is in fact known as the Common Cause judgment, which was delivered by the Supreme Court some time back. And the Supreme Court has said that living wills can only be limited to healthcare issues and cannot encompass property of a person. So living wills at present are not recognized in India, but only to a limited extent, as I said.
Puneet, just last question I'll take from your end. What is the cost of making a will? It is very subjective depending on how complex your will is, how many beneficiaries you want, are there major complications that need to be addressed. So, but to give you a ballpark figure, it can vary from around 20 to 30,000. Registration fees, like Mr. Desai said, they will differ from state to state. Would you know from the top of your head, Mr. Desai, how much does registration cost?
No, not really, because there are schedules in every state, okay. You know, different schedules. And it is, in fact, not much. Yeah. To add something here, we would also, I think we should, you discussed changes in the will. To use a technical term for our people who are present here, see, if a person has made a will and he requires minor changes in the will later on, what can happen? There is a document which is called a codicil under law, C-O-D-I-C-I-L. It's known as a codicil, which basically is a document which says that these are the changes that I am making in my will, which was executed on so-and-so. But as a lawyer, I would say that if you want to make major changes, don't go in for codicils. It is always better to execute a new will after cancelling or revoking the earlier will. If there are minor changes, then codicils should be made. Just to add to that.
Yeah. So Panna, before you move on to the next topic, there's one more question from Mr. Kailash Gupta on HUF. How do you handle HUF?
HUF in a will.
How can properties be? Yeah. So how can HUF properties be divided in the will?
In a will, yes. In fact, Mr. Patel, I believe already answered that question earlier. But to repeat, a person can always say in the will that my portion, whatever falls to my portion of the HUF, I will it to XYZ. Say suppose, for example. To quote an example here, a man, his wife, and two or three children, right? Suppose that is the composition of the family. Suppose the man wants to give his portion to one of his sons rather than all the three of them, whatever considerations that he has, he can definitely do so. Say, suppose 1/5 of the portion is his. He says that my 1/5 of the portion, I leave it to my wife or one of my sons. Ultimately, when the will comes into operation, what will happen is there will be an equal division, but his 1/5 will be added to the already divided portion of the other person. So it may sound unequal in a sense, but can be done, and the law gives that right. Can definitely happen.
Thank you. And I have a question, you know, which was a follow-on question earlier about asset valuation. Because say, for example, you've distinctly given one property to one heir, or, you know, right, as a beneficiary, or another one to another beneficiary.
Right.
And then for God forbid, one of them does not appreciate in value as much as the other.
Correct.
I think one of the best practices which I've been advised is to frequently asset value whatever you have.
Yeah.
And then start amending the wills, you know. So your will has to be reviewed. It's not a one-time document. You need to do that many times in your life.
Yes. At least every 3 to 4 years, a will must be reviewed. Yeah. Evaluations, as you rightly put them, must be made. There is also another way. Suppose it is not an immovable property and is movable property which is being given in this manner. and the values of both properties are different and not likely to change probably, then what happens? Because in the will, there is an unequal distribution. So what happens here? A certain amount, more amount can be given to the person who has been given something of a lesser value, so as to see that things pan out equally for both the beneficiaries. Say, to quote an example, suppose somebody is a connoisseur of high value paintings, famous paintings. He has got, say, two paintings from two famous painters, but their valuations are different. The lesser valuation goes to, say, one son or one daughter. An amount can be added to that in order to see that, okay, both are equal. When a person wants to act equally towards his heirs and children, that can definitely be done. Can happen in case of sculptures also, you know, if they are expensive sculptures and so many expensive things. And we are not talking about immobile property here. Because immobile property, of course, the market factors, government policies, everything counts, you know. Keeps on changing.
Right. I think we'll probably, some of the balance questions, we'll stream it to you, Panna, and hopefully we can do it after the session. Sure, but if you want to move on to the next topic, Panna, on the succession planning. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thanks, Chirag. So like I said earlier, succession planning is deciding who is going to take over your business after you. So it involves putting a plan in place for continuity of the business, planning the next in line successors, and eventually handing down the business baton. So if you're a sole owner of a firm or you run a closely held family business, it is mandatory for you to have a succession plan in place. Okay, people are used to this, you know, playing it by the ear without any special preparation. And to be fair, everyone has some version of succession planning in their heads. But the mistake that most people make is not discussing it actively with their successors, other key senior employees in the organization, and even their family members. So succession planning can feel like an overwhelming process that requires you to consider everything from the past, present, to the future. And it might feel like opening Pandora's box. But it has to be done to ensure that your future generations and the future business is looked after. So passing on the reins can seem difficult, but to ensure the best outcome for your business and heirs, it must be done while you can provide guidance to both your business and your heirs. So Mr. Desai, can you talk about how different types of firms, like as a proprietorship, partnership, private company, or public entity, can go about doing succession planning?
Sure. Opening up with what you yourself mentioned, Panna, you begin with a business which is individually run by a person without any formal structure, say not a partnership or a company or a private limited company, public limited company. Suppose a business is individually owned. How to pass it on? Now, there are two ways in which succession planning can be done so far as an individual business is concerned. One, there can be a separate succession plan, a separate document, which can mention as to how the person wants his business to be run, what are his aspirations for the business in future, and most importantly, whom does he want to give that business to from amongst his heirs, or whether he wants to give the business to the heirs jointly. So a succession plan document can be there.
I'm sorry to interrupt, Mr. Desai. Just for the clarity for our viewers, you're talking about a sole proprietorship here, right?
Sole proprietorship, absolutely. Yes.
Thank you.
So there can be a separate document which has a succession plan. But if a person does not want to have a separate document, what can be done? This can be included in the will itself. See, suppose a person is running a sole proprietorship business. He says that this is the business that I have run for the last 30 years or 35 years. I have built it up to a certain extent. I want that business to be carried forward in this particular fashion, and I leave the business to 1, 2, 3 or whomsoever he wants to give it to. Why? So therefore, there is clarity as to whom that business goes to. So that is so far as a sole proprietorship is concerned. Nothing formal is required to be done here. At best, say, suppose if that sole proprietorship is registered with one of the government or couple of government authorities, a copy of the will can then be presented when it comes into operation, and the changeover in business can happen on the basis of that will. This is sole proprietorship. Now, let us talk about partnership business. Now, despite the fact that our country is more than 70 years old now, there are traditional modes of doing business also, and partnership is a very important mode of doing business, and I am talking about traditional partnerships. I am not talking about limited liability partnerships here, because there would be thousands and thousands of businesses which are run on partnership basis. Say, suppose a person is a partner in a business. How does he deal with the fact that he wants to nominate an heir to get into that business? That can be mentioned in the will that amongst my heirs, I want X or Y to become a partner in the business. But I'll add a caveat here. In a partnership business, what will happen is there would be a document of partnership which is known as the partnership deed. That will normally govern as to how the heirs of a person can get into the business. If it is not mentioned, then the Partnership Act itself takes over and they would not get to be part of the business. So two things need to happen here if a person wants to nominate one of his heirs to get into the partnership business. One, it must be mentioned in the document of partnership, that is the partnership deed, and it must also be mentioned in the will. But again, there is a twist here, and this has proved important time and again. This can happen only in a case where there are more than two partners in a partnership business. And why am I saying that? Suppose there are only two partners in a partnership business and one of them dies. And suppose the document of partnership has said that I nominate XYZ, my heir, to become a partner in the firm. Can that happen? Simple answer is no, it cannot happen. Why? Because as per law, even though you have said that my heir will become a partner upon my death, because there are two partners, the moment one of the partners dies, the partnership firm ceases to exist. Now, what is the way out here? And this is actually part of succession planning, I would say. It must be mentioned in the document of partnership itself here that we are aware that we are only two partners, and if one of us dies, then the firm will come to an end. However, immediately upon this eventuality happening, a new firm will come into existence with one of the original partners who is surviving and the heir of the deceased partner. Of course, this will entail fresh registrations and fresh Aadhaar numbers and all that now. But it will be seen that the continuity of the business is there.
So now private companies and public listed companies.
Yes. Now, if we move on to private companies, as we all of us know, they are not companies that are listed on the stock exchange. Shares are held privately. What can happen here? A person who is a director in a private limited company, if he makes a will and by way of succession planning, he says that I am a director or say the managing director or chairman of a particular company and I hold so many shares of that company. And I want that my son or my daughter upon my death becomes a director in the company. Can that happen? It will not happen automatically upon death. And why is that? Here, the provisions of the Companies Act have to be seen. And more importantly, the company documents have to mention as to what will happen in case of death of a director. If it is mentioned in a particular manner, then yes, as I said in partnership earlier, if the company documents, that is the article and memorandum, mention it, and if it is also there in the will, then both of the things can go together. But again, with a caveat, the person has to be elected to the board of directors after all, as per law. Otherwise, the person just becomes an ordinary shareholder in the company. So, one, it has to be mentioned in the company documents, and second, in the will. This is so far as private limited companies are concerned. Similar thing with public limited companies, not much of a difference. Similar thing would be there so far as public limited companies are concerned. The company documents have to be looked at. Otherwise, the person just ends up being a shareholder in the company.
So, a lot of times people ask, you know, what is a good time to start a succession plan or what will happen if you don't have a succession plan in place? So, I would say it's never too early to put a succession plan in place, especially if you consider a crisis, because it could happen either today, tomorrow. You know, what's going to happen to your business if a plan is not in place? Who unlocks the door tomorrow, the next morning? And once the doors are unlocked, who the employees show up for work, who is going to manage these employees, right? So these are important considerations to think about. The purpose of the succession plan is to get the business and the next generation future ready. When I mean by preparing a business, what I mean by preparing a business is you have to, if the business has established and proven systems for operating, then the successors can easily fill in your shoes, right? And they're better equipped to manage the business. Also, it is possible that it takes a very long time depending on the candidates or the successors' intelligence and skill set to be adequately ready to fill in your shoes when you're no longer there, right? So it is a gradual and slow process. As a rule of thumb, that the higher the number of shareholders in a business family, the more important it becomes that you discuss a succession plan or a family agreement. Mr. Desai, if you can talk a little bit about the family agreement part.
Yes. Now, this is something which is very important. In fact, it covers both aspects of the talk today. The earlier portion about succession to property and also succession to business. Now, in law, there is something which is recognized as a family arrangement or a family settlement. It's alternatively known as these two. Now, what can a family arrangement or settlement do? Basically, it is a document in order to see to it that not only are, say, certain assets divided in a certain manner, but also a business can be divided or dealt with in a family settlement or arrangement. Such a typical document would mention as to whom the business goes to, in what manner is the business to be run, and everything. Why does a family arrangement assume significance? Because one of the most important words used here is to maintain peace and harmony in the family are the words used, so that there are no future disputes. That document is in fact taking care of the fact that there are no future disputes. Now, I can see a question on the screen as to whether a family settlement or arrangement is required to be registered or not. Yes, if it deals with immovable property, yes, it would be required to be registered. But if it is, the law says that if it takes into consideration something that has already happened, then it probably will not require registration. But at the time when it comes into operation, if it deals with certain immovable property aspects, then it will have to be registered as per the registration law.
So some considerations that you can think about while you make a succession plan is things like, you know, you address things like, do family members who are not currently in the business and intend to join the business? What is their vision? Do their individual objectives align with your family business? Should the business at any point be sold to provide for liquidity in case the family needs some? And who will take over running the business if it's not sold? Do they have the required skill set? Whether you want additional professional assistance from outside to without taking ownership, of course, to provide assistance in managing the daily activities of the business. You know, so be proactive about preparing a plan. Do a trial run of your succession plan. So don't wait for a crisis to check whether the plan works or not. Get your potential successors to, you know, assume the roles and responsibilities that you normally perform for the business and see whether how they perform. So that can provide valuable experience to them, and you can further plug in any loopholes that you detect during the trial period, right? Now, this is something that is very, very important to me. It talks about, you know, in today's world, daughters must get an equal share. But so this is a question from one of the participants, and they've given it to us earlier on. So I'm going to read the question as it is. In today's world, daughters must get an equal share. But does it really happen? Because the son feels that he has been working alongside with the father since a young age. And let us say that the daughter has not been working at it and she's probably married and gone away. So the son continues to put in his hard work to make the family business grow. How do you divide, how should the father divide these things then? You can give your points and then of course I'm going to add mine.
Of course. Now look, so far as daughters are concerned and Hindu law is concerned, in 2005, there was a very, very important amendment in the Hindu Succession Act, which said that equal rights are given to daughters in family property. Now, that family property obviously would also, in family-run businesses, it would include the family-run business also. Now, as you said, the question was that the son feels that, oh, I am putting in all the effort. My sister is not putting in that much of an effort, or she is married. And why should she be given a part in the business, or maybe even the assets, other assets, personal assets? The answer is in the question itself, I would say. And why did the legislature, why did the law say that daughters are equal? They come from the same source as the sons. Can the sons say that the daughter is born differently? That is one. They have been treated equally and they must get their shares. And the law does not make a distinction between married and unmarried daughters at all. They are equally situated.
Fair enough. So we've run into the exact same problem while dealing with a client in Delhi. And without taking any names, I'll explain to you what this client did eventually. So he ended up saying that whatever my assets are, I have created them till date. Whatever the value of the company is today, I'm going to divide it equally amongst all my children. Okay. Anybody who's working within the company can get salary for the work that they do. Okay. Going ahead, if the business grows substantially, then any valuation addition that the son would have provided to the business can be given to him alone. That's not a problem because it's his work that took the company from point A to point B, for example. Mm. And I think you should also, a fair way to do this is talk to your families. Go back and ask what they expect from you, because a lot of time the answer would come just by having a healthy discussion. I know it seems the impolite thing to do, and it might lead to some tough conversations, but it's better to have the conversation. Because ask what the working member wants, and what are the requirements of the non-working member. You know, are they financially taken care of? And was the daughter given the opportunity, and was it a willing decision to not participate in the work, or was it an unwilling decision? Because that would lead to a completely different outcome, right? So while it's very, very subjective, I would say talking to everybody together usually helps you coming down to a fair solution.
Now, there was a question on the screen that I saw right now. Suppose somebody has made a will, it said, leaving everything to the son and nothing to the daughter. Can this be challenged in a court of law? No.
It cannot.
Simply said, no. Why? Because it is the self-acquired property of the person, and therefore cannot be dealt with. If it is family property, then obviously the daughter has a share. Another question that I saw repeatedly was, is it a good idea to get the signatures of the beneficiaries on the will? No, not required as per law. In fact, the beneficiaries need not know as to what they are going to get. And it's not required that their signature should be there on the will. They are not attesting or approving the will. Otherwise, the will loses its own sheen, you know. The whole idea of making a will goes out of the window.
So, Mr. Desai, this entire concept of estate planning can be executed either through a will or through a trust. Generally, these are the two instruments used. Can you talk to us a little about trusts, please?
Yes. Now, when we talk about trusts as a mode of, say, estate planning or even succession planning to some extent, or more of estate planning, what is a trust? How is a trust created? See, suppose somebody wants to create a trust to try and see to it that suppose the education of his children is taken care of, or other needs of the children and the family are taken care of, then the person would create what is known as a trust, a private trust, of course. We are talking about private trusts here and not public trusts that are popularly known. So a private trust would be created with, say, a certain amount. Say, to quote an example, suppose a person wants to create a trust, and he has got a capital of, say, 50 lakh rupees. He creates a trust with that 50 lakh rupees and says in the trust that the educational needs of my children, the medical needs of my children will come out of the interest that is generated from the investments that are made in the trust, from the trust. So that way a separate entity has been created, which is completely independent of the person making the trust. And that is how, that is also a mode of planning, financial planning. Now here, there is something very important. There are two ways in which property can be put into a trust. Suppose someone, as I said, I quoted the figure, fictional figure of say 50 lakhs. Suppose someone says that, okay, I am setting aside 50 lakh rupees from out of the interest that is generated. It will go towards the expenses for my children and my family. A trust is created, but he still, that person still retains control over that 50 lakhs. From the taxation point of view, what will happen here? That person will be taxed and not the trust. But if a formal trust is created and that 50 lakh rupees is itself put in trust separately, then the trust will be taxed separately and the person who has made the trust will not be taxed on that. So there are two different things. So when we talk about, say, a trust, I am saying that a separate trust should be created interest which is generated will go towards the needs of the children. Say suppose when they reach the age of say 25, if it is mentioned in the trust that at their age of 25 or at a particular time, a particular year can be named, that trust would be dissolved. Therefore, obviously the interest would cease and the original or the principal amount of the trust should be divided amongst the beneficiaries themselves. That is normally what is mentioned in a trust. So you are doing two things here. One, you are getting them to get the interest. And second, at the end of that period, when the trust comes to an end, they get the amounts. So that is another mode. So, oh, interesting question. Do you think estate duty will come back? I couldn't read the rest of the question, but this is very important. Now, this I would relate to building up trusts. And in fact, in a pre-session, Panna herself asked me a question as to why people are not making many trusts these days. The question which the person put here, one of our viewers put here, itself answers that. Earlier, trusts were being made only in order to see that the person gets out at least substantially from paying estate duty. Now, if people are not aware, what is estate duty? Estate duty is simply put death duties. A person dies, his estate is amenable to, or his property is amenable to pay death duties or estate duties to the government. Now, that was done away. Estate duties were quite high then, just like income tax. At one point of time, the income tax rates were humongous. Same thing with estate duty. But estate duty has been done away with. Sorry?
Mr. Deshe, the taxes are still humongous. Not once upon a taxes. Time. current taxes
are yeah. Humongous. Yeah, of course. Maybe they'll, let's hope they come down in future. Not saying anything much because that is a part of government policy.
As taxpayers, it's our job to complain about the tax rate. So we are allowed to do that.
yes, every Indian is allowed to do that because death and taxes are the only two things that are certain, as they say. But coming back to this, the question was, do you think that estate duty will come back? Well, it's very difficult to answer. It depends upon what the government thinks on this aspect. And I would not venture a guess. Of course, a couple of years back, there was some kind of a rumor that estate duties are coming back. I had queries from all over the country, believe me, you, on this aspect as to what will we do now when it comes back. I said, probably people will go back to the old system of trusts and some other methods, which are, in fact, legally permissible.
Okay. Mr. Desai, just one question. Suppose you have a list of 20 assets that you own today, okay, movable, immovable, both. Now, yes. I want to move them into a trust. Yes. What will be the costs and the process? Will I have to sell them and buy them again? Will I have to, can I transfer them? Will I have a transfer fee? How will this go and how will the taxation work?
Oh, yes. See, simplest and the best thing to do here would be that buying selling portion should not be done because that would result into multiple documents.
Correct.
Say, as you rightly pointed out, suppose you own a particular property, say immovable property, for example, and you want to put that in trust, probably wanting to see to it that that property is given out on rent. Correct. Because it's a huge property. And the rent that is generated from that goes towards the benefit of the beneficiaries.
Correct.
It can straight away be put into the trust. Of course, it will entail a fresh registration, etc. But it can straight away go to the trust. You need not, sell it to the trust, etc. You can just put it into the trust. Ownership will change hands and the beneficiaries will then start getting the rental income as their, rights from the trust till the time that the trust is in existence.
considering that the registry cost in immovable properties is very high, would you still advise this, or how should we do it?
To take a very pragmatic view of the situation, at least so far as Gujarat is concerned, the registration costs have gone down to maybe about 6.25%. Earlier, of course, you know the rates. So I would, in fact, you have posed a very interesting question here. And why I would say that this 6.25% is quite all right. I have repeatedly been asked by some individuals in the past. You see, they want a certain thing to have about immovable property to happen in a certain manner, say transfer from one entity to another. The pointed question asked to me was, we want to do this in order to see that our heirs do not suffer, but our problem is that we will have to end up paying registration fees. I said, you have to do that. If you want peace of mind for your heirs, please pay up the registration fees and get it over with. Otherwise, it will not be a proper transfer if you try and do it in any other manner whatsoever. Because that's mandated by the law. The ownership is changing. Has to be done.
So, thank you guys for attending. So, just to wrap up, and before we take the questions, I'm just going to say, making an efficient estate and succession plan allows you to plan for the future beyond you. You will not only put your mind at ease today, but also ensure the best outcome for your loved ones and leave a good legacy behind. So, Chirag, can we open the floor for questions, please?
Yeah, sure. So, Arun, if you can open the questions, and I think I would like to summarize that from what I understand, what you have said, sir, is to actually think ahead, get all the assets listed down, figure out who should be the beneficiaries, including your business, whatever type is your business. I think that thinking you have to do yourself, and then appoint experts to help you through in terms of documentation, registration, etc.
True, very true.
So very, very valuable, very simple advice as well. I'm hoping that most people will follow it.
And I don't know, if you can just unmute especially anybody, when the businesses are family owned, you know, more important than family owned businesses are there.
Yeah, I mean, most of the participants here are family-run businesses, as you can see from the question.
I see.
So, Arun, if you can unmute, and we'll just take randomly three questions and then end the session.
Hi, Chiraz. I have a question. This is Shino.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead, Shino.
Thanks very much for very insightful tips. My question is, if as promoters we have given personal guarantees to our investors, how do we protect them in case of any mishappening for our heirs?
I think a trust would be the best way to do it. Mr. Desai, would you want to take it over?
Personal guarantees, as in what circumstance have the personal guarantees been given?
Towards the business, in case there is any problem in the business and if the personal guarantees are forsaken, how do we, what methods to put in
how,
place?
How do you protect your heirs?
Yes, that's right.
Okay, very good question. Now the law answers your question itself. Here, what happens is that your heirs will not be personally responsible for it. What would be responsible is the property that you own. There, because, again, with the change in law, at least so far as the Hindu law is concerned, see, under old Hindu law, we had something which was called pious obligation. A son or a grandson was bound to honor the debts of his fathers or forefathers. But that has been done away with so far as the amendment to the Hindu Succession Act is concerned. However, when you talk about a formal document, say, suppose somebody has given, as you said, a guarantee in a bank towards a loan, then that person's property will be responsible. There will not be any personal responsibility on the heirs at all.
Thank you.
Next question, please. Anybody?
So, a husband and a wife both can make a will together?
Or yes.
They have to make a,
Yes, definitely. They are known as mutual wills. typically what happens in mutual wills is this. The husband and the wife make these wills together. Both wills will contain clauses saying that, say, if one survives the other, then the other person gets the property. That would be mentioned in both the wills. And then succession would, of course, be named as to how things are to happen. The reason why your question assumes a significance and importance is, again, without naming the case, there was a very high profile case in India about mutual wills. After they had made, the husband and the wife had made mutual wills. After the husband passed away, the wife wanted to change her will and she changed it. That, of course, was the subject matter of a challenge, which has resulted into litigation, which is going on till date, in fact. So basically, when mutual wills are made, they are not open to change because both have done things in a certain manner. But husband and wife can definitely make mutual wills.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome.
If nobody is asking, I have another question. That can you just write that, okay, if this happens, then that happens, like, or let us say that I want to keep 10% of my asset to, let us say, charity. So can I do that? Or it has to be very clear that this has to be the amount?
Oh, yes, yes. See, if it is your self-acquired property and you feel I want to give 10% or 15% of my assets or property to charity, that can definitely be done. There is no restriction on that at all.
So he raised an interesting point about, you know, whether you can put other conditions as well. So yeah, charity, of course, 10-15% is fine. But can your will be conditional? If these conditions are met, then this asset goes to these people.
Correct.
Otherwise, it is addressed.
Normally, such conditions are frowned down upon by courts. Say, to quote a condition here, just off the top of the head. Suppose a person has two or three children. One of the children is unmarried. But the father may be wanting that that son or that daughter gets married. Okay, I bequeath such and such amount to my son or my daughter, so and so, on the condition that the person gets married. Can't happen.
Okay.
Such a condition cannot be put.
Okay, fair enough.
Regarding the husband and the wife, the mutual will that you just said.
Yes.
So just one more thing regarding that. Supposing you want to make sure the wife is protected, and yet you want to bequeath a certain amount to your children later.
Yes.
You don't want the entire amount going to the wife. Can you make it conditional that the wife cannot, at a later stage, side with one of your heirs, and can get just a certain part, and yet that, you know, that entire part will then further be divided by the wife equally between your heirs after her.
Correct. That can definitely. The will, and that can definitely happen. Your portion of the will can say that, okay, this particular portion goes to my wife. She will not be able to deal with it till her lifetime. She will get the interest out of that, but she will not be able to deal with the principal amount. And after her death, it will be divided in a particular manner. Can definitely be done. And why is that? Again, the law mandates it here. I hope you can hear me.
Yeah.
The law mandates it here.
Yes, we can.
Yes. The law mandates it here. If I talk about Hindu law, then under the Hindu Succession Act, there are, say, two or three sections which deal with the succession by a wife. One is, of course, Section 14 is the most important here, which says that any property that is given to a Hindu female is her own property and she can deal with it in any manner whatsoever. But the second portion of the section, without going into technicalities, says that if a limited estate is created, or if the property has been given in a limited manner, then that portion of the property cannot be dealt with by that person. That should answer your question.
Good. I think we are way behind over time, actually. So thank you very much, Mr. Desai and Panna, for an enlightening session. Clearly, I think all of us have to do a lot of work for those of us who have not written a will or have done succession planning. And I'm sure if there are any further questions which come up, we'll just email it to them, email it to you, and we'll sort of keep in touch. And on behalf of Thai Rajasthan, thank you very much. Stay safe, and hopefully all of this will be behind us, and hopefully we can meet you face to face, and we would like
to invite you. It would be a real pleasure, and thank you for having us over for this wonderful session. Very, very nicely moderated.
Thank you, Panna. Thanks a lot for all your help as well. Fantastic.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.